here in a minute. Talking transitions. And as we are looking at transition, just I've been asked a number of times exactly what's going on. We are finished at the end of January here. Technically, I started at Lancaster Bible on February 1st, but in between here and there, my family is going down to Puerto Rico it's kind of a slash vacation slash missions trip slash work trip. So Nathan went there with the church this last summer, and we'd been kind of looking for a trip as a family. certain members of our family will be turning 50 in this coming year. Another one, 21, 18, 16. So we were kind of looking at this year, okay, what can we do? And we couldn't decide. I know that's hard to believe. A family of five could not decide on a destination. But when we threw out Puerto Rico, everyone really jumped at that. So we are excited. I twisted Dave Markle's arm. I said, Dave, would you guys like to join us in Puerto Rico in February when it's really cold here? And Dave, he prayed long and hard about it and said yes. So actually, I don't think he had to pray too long. He just knows that's God's will for him to be down there at certain times. So in February is always a good time to be down there. So we're looking forward to that. Like I said, well, it's vacation, but it's also time to be a blessing, to do whatever we can do to help out with Betsy there. But then it'll also be work-related as well, as I'll be looking at that and talking to Betsy. Is that a possible destination? We can take the students who are in the GAP program at LBC down there for a missions trip and to help Betsy and just be a good experience for those students as well. So appreciate your prayers. We'll probably, with being away the beginning of February, and then just kind of have a break here between being here and not being here. We probably won't be here at all in February, but then you will probably see us in March and April because we don't plan on moving right away. So if you see us here, please don't, you know, run us out. But we'll look forward to still worshiping with you in the coming months. But hopefully that kind of at least gives you an idea of how God is leading us and some of the timing. You know, and as I was thinking of today, make it through today, it'll be good. Some of the struggles in my heart for the past few months have been, wow, I've only been here 3.5 years. And am I running? You know, I've been asked, oh, you're leaving because of the changes. No. I think by God's word showing you that some of those changes and directions are really driven by God's word. And as we, as an elder team, have really dug into God's word, I hope you know that that has been the heartbeat behind everything, is this. Not a man, not a book, but the book. And you know, in a sense, I kind of feel like Paul today in some of his letters. I want to express my thanks. Then I'd also like to express some encouragement as well. And you know, part of my encouragement would be, please allow this to always be your guide. And you know, I'll admit, I had a little bit of a disappointment a couple weeks ago when the changes didn't go through. Not because Dave was wanting them, but because really, as the spiritual leaders that you put in front of you spent time, I witnessed, on our knees. Spent time just allowing this book to guide our hearts. And then not to follow that. That was a disappointment, I admit. Because we must always allow this to be our guide. And when God has placed leaders who are not taking you away from this, may I encourage you today to follow? Yeah, of course, if they are taking you away from this, no, we should never. That's our first guide. But if it's not in contradiction to this, then follow that godly leadership, because they are the ones who will give an account when they stand before Christ. And a humility should mark our body to submit to leadership. Just as a wife is called to submit to a husband's authority in the home, and that doesn't mean a husband rules with an iron fist. So God has asked the body to submit to the godly leadership, and that doesn't mean, again, that the leadership rules with an iron fist, but that humility that should mark us as a body. And you know, as I was really thinking through and struggling with being here for 3.5 years, my mind went to Acts 20:31. If you'd open up your Bibles to Acts chapter 20. Acts 20:31 says, "Therefore, be alert, remembering that for 3 years I did not cease night or day to admonish everyone with tears." And here Paul, Luke is recounting for us Paul's really last time with the Ephesian elders, as he had gathered the elders together, and he reminds them that he had been with them for 3 years. And as I had been struggling over leaving, the Lord brought me to this passage, and you know, the Lord gave Paul 3 wonderful years with the Ephesian believers. And I took great encouragement from that, because then instead of thinking, Lord, thank you so much for the 3.5 years that you allowed me to be a part of this body. And you know, there were good times and there were bad times for Paul with the Ephesians. I mean, there was a mob riot in Ephesus over the power of the gospel. I'm sure they weren't voting for that. You know, yeah, let's have a huge riot and let's, you know, in this. But, you know, there were also wonderful times with Paul in the Ephesians. As he was walking the street, it talks about in Acts his handkerchief, the garments from his workplace. You know, they would heal people. Just his shadow would heal people. Now, I'm not trying to make that connection between me and Paul. I'm just saying there were good times and there were difficult times. And you know, as I look out on the body, there are so many good times. I look out and I rejoice. I see individuals who God brought to himself in the last 3.5 years. It's so precious. I look out and I see difficult times. I see empty spaces, not because of the snow. Okay, there are lots of empty spaces today, but that's understandable. Many have gone to be with their Savior in the last 3.5 years. Some, as this week, celebration of life of Elmer Hom. You know, as I talked to his son at the service, there was almost that joy of, you know, God gave Dad 98 wonderful years to serve him, and he's taken him home. And there was that joy. But then there's always difficulty in death. But as I look out, we stood over graves of infants. And those are hard times. There are empty spaces of individuals who have just left the body. And those are holes in the body. I had it said to me one time, well, people come and people go. Not from a body. People just don't go. You don't just cut your right arm off and say, huh, limbs come, limbs go. That hurts. And I hope you recognize how special body life is, and that it becomes a preeminent part, if it's not a preeminent part of your life, that it continues to grow and be a preeminent part of your life. And I can say with Paul, as he told the Ephesians, as he wrote to them, that I do not cease to give thanks for you. And as I continue to read in Acts chapter 20, the verse that just jumped out at me in this time of transition and thinking, okay, what do you preach in kind of a final farewell sermon? And thankfully, I've had a number say to me, some of the elders have said, this doesn't have to be the last time that you preach. And I'm thankful for that, and I look forward, if you would ask me to come back and share in the Word with you. But the Lord just kept directing my heart and my mind to verse 32 of Acts chapter 20, where Paul says, "And now I commend you to God and to the word of his grace, which is able to build you up and to give you the inheritance among all those who are sanctified." Because as we look at that verse, this is what Paul says: I commend you to God and to the word of his grace. What else can I commend you to? I could be up here, I could give emotional appeals to this or that, or best thing I can do is commend you to God. And by commending you to God, these are really one and the same thing here. These aren't separate, to God and to the Word. No, I commend you this morning to God and to the Word of His grace. Why? Well, He gives us two reasons then that we want to look at. Because these are what are able to build you up. These are what are able to edify you. And these are what are able to give you the inheritance among those who are sanctified. So as my time draws to a close here in this format with you, this is what I would like to leave with you. First of all, looking at commending you to the word of his grace. And may I remind you of two aspects of God's grace this morning. First of all, the gospel. Just a couple pages over in your Bibles from Acts, Paul says, as he is really dying to go see the Roman believers, he says to them in verse 15, "I am eager to preach the gospel to you who are in Rome, because I am not ashamed of the gospel." And you know, as we think of the word of God's grace, are you overwhelmed by the gospel this morning? Paul was eager to preach, and think about this, he was eager to preach the gospel to the believers in Rome. When we usually think of preaching the gospel, we think of what? Evangelizing the lost. But he says here in Romans, no, I want to preach, I'm eager to preach the gospel to you who are in Rome, because only the radical news concerning Jesus Christ can distract us from all of life's trivial pursuits. Remember that game, Trivial Pursuit? Maybe some of you have it in the bottom of a closet somewhere. I hated that game. Why? Because it was trivial. And you always had that one person at the table that knew all the trivia of the world and could just, and you're like, really? You know that? Me, give me last night with my daughter, let me play Dutch Blitz and school my daughter on how to play Dutch Blitz. Now, I won't say which daughter, and she would probably argue, but we could pull out the score sheet and show you that. But, you know, trivia, don't we get distracted by a lot of trivia? The wall. Government shutdown. Now, government shutdown can affect a lot of lives, so I'm not trying to trivialize that aspect of it, But you know, in our culture, we can get caught up with a lot of trivia. And when I say trivia, I think things that take us away from here. Away from what really matters. Only the gospel can cause such a radical reevaluation of our core identity that we're willing, like Paul, to throw away what we thought was a great resume in exchange for being found in Christ. Are you overwhelmed by the fact that you are found in Christ today? Because the gospel ultimately leads me to God. Forgive me, but let me read just a brief page here on the gospel. In the New Testament, the gospel is several times referred to as the gospel of God. I think very similar to what we're reading here in Acts chapter 20, verse 32, when he says, he commends them to God and to the word of his grace. Such an expression, the gospel of God, should be understood in the fullest sense possible. The gospel is called the gospel of God, not simply because it is from God, nor merely because it is accomplished through God, but because ultimately it leads me to God, who is himself its greatest prize. Is Christ God your greatest prize today? We're a few weeks past Christmas. Probably, you know, parents, your kids, you bought them some really cool Christmas presents. Generally, by now, though, is what when they've start to lose their luster a little bit. It's not the cool toy anymore, and they're back to just building blocks, playing with that doll that they've had their whole life. As Christ should never lose his luster with us. Indeed, what makes the gospel such great news is God, who brings me to himself and then gives himself so freely to me through Jesus Christ. The essence of eternal life is not, this is going to sound shocking, the essence of eternal life is not found in having my sins forgiven. It's not found in possessing a mansion in heaven. It's not found in having streets of gold on which to walk forever. Rather, the essence of eternal life is intimately knowing God and Jesus Christ, whom he has sent. Everything else that God gives to me in the gospel serves merely to bring me to himself, so that this great end might be achieved. And as I meditate on the gospel each day, I find my thoughts inevitably traveling from the gifts I've received to the giver of those gifts. Are you overwhelmed by the gospel today? It leads us to God. Romans reminds us, you know, as I meditate on the gospel every day, I deserve God's wrath. But instead of leading me now to God's wrath, the gospel has led me to Jesus Christ himself. And Romans 5 reminds me of the grace. Mary Poppins is out again. Good timing. Because what's her favorite word? One of her favorite. What's one of the words she may have coined? Jen, bold it out there for us. All right. Supercalifragilisticexpialidocious. Mary Poppins was studying the Greek in Romans chapter 5 when she coined that term. Because really, that is what Paul is trying to say there. God's grace is overabundantly supercalifragilisticexpialidocious. It's amazing, to coin the hymn that we've so many times sung. Grace, God's grace is amazing. And when I sin, what does God give me? His grace. Now, he reminds us in chapter 6, okay, but we don't think, okay, then I sin and I get more grace. No, 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 no. But chapter 7 reminds me what? The things I want to do, what do? I don't do them. The things I shouldn't do, what do I find myself doing? Oh, wretched man that I am. And again, the end of chapter 7 leads me to Christ. And the answer is Christ. And God's grace is what allows me to resist sin. Accurately understanding and continually applying the gospel, then, it's not just what gets me into the Christian life, it is the Christian life. And so, as I leave you really with these final words today, part of what I want to leave you is that reminder of the gospel. The gospel is the word of God's grace. Another thing that we must remember then is we must never become grace graduates. When do I ever stop needing God's grace? When I stop needing God's grace, then really, what am I? I'm a Pharisee. We don't want friends who are grace graduates, do we? Because then they are, well, I don't struggle with that. Yeah, but you struggle with. Well, just try harder. They don't get God's grace. Parents, your kids don't want parents who think they're grace graduates, who forget they need God's grace just as much as their children need God's grace. And when we ever get over God's grace, woe to us. We must never become grace graduates. And how do we never become grace graduates? We're in the source of his grace every day. I remind you, Paul starts every one of his letters with the phrase, grace to you, or grace from God. What's he saying? Well, he ends every one of his letters with the phrase, except he switches the preposition. At the beginning of his letter, he says, grace to you. At the end of every one of his letters, he says, grace be with you. What's he saying? Another part of God's grace is what? This. Paul was saying, look, part of God's grace is God's word. And Paul got it. As he was writing every one of his letters, as he starts out, he says, okay, God's grace to you. And he's going to give that body a letter, not from Paul, although little author, it is Paul, big author. This is God's grace because this is God's revealed, inspired word of God. And it's going to tell you how to manage and how to live every day. That's God's grace, isn't it? And again, when I remember, whoa, this is from God himself. That's just overwhelming, isn't it? And part of God's grace is the gospel. Another part of God's grace is his word. Except the problem can be often that what? We can become too familiar with it, can't we? We can become familiar with the gospel. Yes, I've been saved from wrath. I have a relationship with Jesus Christ, and he has saved me from sin. And I always have this. I have a hard copy. It's on my electronic device. So how often was that app used this last week? How often was the hard copy dusted off this last week? I've shared this with you before, and honestly, I've shared just about everything I'm sharing with you in the past 3.5 years, and I realize that. But the law of familiarity, if you're around anything long enough, what do? we tend to take it just a little bit for granted. Therefore, every day, you must reassociate the value of what you do. And isn't that really just our quiet time with Christ every day? To get our minds off of the trivial, get our minds off of Fox News, or whichever one you want, get our minds focused on what really matters. God's grace. What God has done for each and every one of us through the gospel. So in my desire to commend you to God and to the word of his grace, my family has a gift for you today. As you leave, there are a number of copies out in the foyer here on two tables, Family Connection Service, back at as you leave there as well on the table. If you're live streaming, sorry. There's still time to get here. This is called a gospel primer. Some of you may know it. It's by Milton Vincent, and what it's designed to do is give you no more than what I read to you earlier of the impact of the gospel to our lives. And like a diamond that has so many different facets on it, what I saw this week, men, we all failed. I saw Tim Tebow, what, like a 7.5-carat diamond he just gave to his fiance. It's like, whoa. Sorry, Deb. But the gospel is like a multifaceted diamond, right? It's really like the hope of diamond, even better. But you know, you take the hope diamond and all the facet cuts and the facets on that diamond, that's really the gospel in our lives, right? There are so many different ways the gospel impacts our lives. And that's really all this book is intended to do, is Milton Vincent takes the gospel and every day gives you a short reminder of how the gospel impacts your life. And so it's not something, you know, it's like, oh, another thing to do. No, just, it's a way, this is a tool to be refreshed briefly in the gospel every day. And so these are available. There's at least one per family, unless you're live streaming and don't get here. Then there'll probably be more copies today with the snow. But I would ask if you take one per family, and then if you're still here and there's copies left, feel free to take them. But again, I want to put really feet to what I'm saying here today, not just commending you to the gospel with words, but I want to commend you to the gospel with something, a tool that can help you live the gospel each and every day. And what are the reasons that Paul commends the Ephesian elders here to the gospel, to the word of God's grace? Well, the first reason he gives here, he says in verse 32, it's able to build you up. It's able to build you up. Now, the term edify or build up here, it is a construction term. I don't know about you. If I see a pile of lumber like that, I kind of am like, what do you do with it? You know, there are some individuals who can take that pile of lumber and they can make something out of it. They can take a pile and they can construct a frame. They can take a pile of lumber, they can construct just about anything. I was a kid, I tried to make a doghouse. No doghouse, no dog would want to live in it. You know, it's not my gifting. But all of us are called to edify one another, right? Now here, what is Paul saying though? He's not talking about us edifying one another. He's not even talking about what Peter said in 1 Peter chapter 2 when we looked at 1 Peter, when we studied 1 Peter, where he says, you yourselves like living stones are being built up as a spiritual house to be a holy priesthood to offer spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God through Christ Jesus. There he was talking about Christ's role in our lives, building us up, edifying us, making us a body here. But here in Acts chapter 20, verse 32, what's he saying? I commend you to God and to the word of his grace, again, one and the same thing, which is able to build you up. God's word edifies. God's word builds us up. So I've talked already about the personal application of being in God's word. Let me talk right now, though, about another application. How often are you putting yourself under the teaching of God's word in the local church? I think we'd agree. The book of Acts is a clear example of it. The entire book of Acts is the expansion of God's kingdom here on this earth through the planting and establishing of local churches. Now, you might say, we're here today, aren't we? I think it has priority in our lives. Paul told Timothy in 1 Timothy chapter 3, verse 15, he describes the church as the household of God, which is the church of the living God, a pillar and buttress of the truth. Is this a priority to you? Is this time where we gather together every week a priority? Or a matter of, if it's convenient, I'll fit it in, and if not, can the first thing kind of push it away from us? Are you really engaged in body life? Are you submitting yourself weekly to the time where, as a body, we submit ourselves to God's word, not just through the preaching of God's word, but through the music of God's word, through the giving? Is this a priority? You know, I'm reminded of the example, and let me give you an example from that Will Farley gives in his Gospel-Centered Parenting. Ken and Jackie were sincere parents. But their sincerity was their problem. They loved their children. In fact, they loved them too much. Their oldest son was a talented athlete. He excelled on the local U16 soccer team. Because the team practiced during the dinner hour, the family stopped eating meals together. They had been in the habit of praying and reading their Bibles after meals, and that also ended. Their daughter was an exceptionally talented ballerina. Her lessons were expensive. Ken and Jackie couldn't afford them and tithe at the same time. We will resume tithing when she graduates, they rationalized. Soon the family was traveling to weekend soccer tournaments. Most were on Sunday, so church attendance became increasingly sporadic. And do you see what just happened to gradually take part of this family? The trivial things of this world became the focus, and the things of Christ became matters of convenience. The result for this family was soon church became an option. Eventually, the children went off to college. Within a few years, they had both quit attending church. They forgot God. They threw themselves into their real interests, athletics, dancing. Ken and Jackie were deeply troubled. Typically, who do we blame as parents? The church? The pastors? Sunday school teacher didn't reach out to my child like they should have? Who's the greatest influence, though, to show them the primacy of and the high priority that should be spending time in God's word in the local church? In contrast, he goes on and talks about Tim and Angie centered their home in God and his will. Tim told his son's soccer coach, "My son will be available any day but Sunday." Tim happened to be the best player on the team. Do you think he ever got pressured into playing? Tim found out that his daughter's piano lessons would be during the family dinner hour. He gently asked her to find another teacher, reminding her that the family dinner hour was sacred. Tim's decisions might seem small, but they had immense long-term consequences. Tim's decisions disappointed his children in the short run, but won them for Christ in the long run. Now, the wrong thing from those illustrations is to say, okay, wait, back up. What exact decisions did they make? No, that's not the point. The point is, what was their priority? And who else but our children know really what's the priority? Is Christ the priority? Is spending time together as a body the priority? I looked at the law of familiarity a little bit before. Let me just change a little bit here. If you're around anything long enough, you tend to take it just a little bit for granted. Therefore, every Sunday, you must reassociate the value of what you do. Is it important to you to be spending time with God's people under God's word? Why? The reason we should, Paul tells us right here in Acts, it builds us up. And not only does it build us up, but number two, he talks about our inheritance. Our inheritance among those who are sanctified. So the God and the word of his grace is able to build us up, and it's able to give us an inheritance among those who are sanctified. And so really, my last exhortation is one that, again, I've given to you before. Are you living with an eternal focus? Hey, you are a co-heir with Jesus Christ. Any inheritance in this life, then, what? That pales in comparison to the inheritance that we have in Jesus Christ. So I ask you simply this morning, are you living for the line or for the dot? The dot is this life, isn't it? Maybe 70 years. Been reminded in the past few months, my dad, 92, Elmer, 98. But what is that in light of eternity? Am I focused on the dot? And what happens when I get focused on the dot? Oh, I got to make sure all my portfolios, and I'm not saying there's not wisdom in making sure you're prepared for the end of your life here on this earth. So that's not what I'm saying. But we can get so wrapped up in that inheritance. And we all know what can happen to that inheritance in that given amount of time. It's happened before. What? The stock market wipes out, and so does your investment. Well, just hide it under the mattress. Yeah, and inflation hits, and those dollars you have hidden under your mattress don't really matter anymore, because you can have a wheelbarrow full of them and they won't buy a thing. And we worry about our health. And then that time of retirement comes, and what's happened to our health? Our health maybe isn't what we thought it would be. And we can spend so much time focused on the last 10, 15, 20 years of our life here that we forget what? To commend you to God and the word of his grace, which is able to keep you focused on the inheritance that we have through Jesus Christ. Live for the line and not the dot. You remember what Peter told us in 1 Peter chapter 1? Peter told us that we are being kept to an inheritance that is imperishable, undefiled, unfading, kept in heaven for you, who by God's power are being guarded through faith for a salvation ready to be revealed. And what do I get so focused on? I get so focused on the dot and not the line. You know, the end of the book tells us what's going to happen. Don't you love that about Christ? He doesn't hold it from us. Revelation 17 and 18, what's going to happen? This world is done. The kingdoms of this world are going to be destroyed. And so often, what do I get focused on in my life? I get focused on the things of this world and the kingdoms of this world. And those are exactly what God tells us. Hey, you want that? Okay, but let me go ahead and tell you, this is what's going to happen to it. Revelation 17 and 18, it is going to be destroyed. And Jesus is going to come. And he is going to end things with the Battle of Armageddon. And you know, and all we're doing is we're riding along. We're there in that army. He's leading it. And by the word of his power, he is going to defeat Satan and his forces. And we're just kind of riding along. And we're on the victory side. But I ask us this morning, are we living in light of that? Or are we living for the trivial pursuits of life? Because he makes it very clear, when he comes, there's two destinies, eternal death or eternal life. And when we remember the big picture, shouldn't we say with the hymn writer, the things of this earth should grow strangely dim? But it's not just that they should grow strangely dim. Why do they grow strangely dim? Because of the light of his glory. If we could go back, and Sue, forgive me for using your dad, but if we could grab Elmer back right now, he would never want to come back. Because the light of Jesus' glory is overwhelming him. But you know what? Because of the gospel, it should be overwhelming each and every one of us here today. Because when does eternal life begin? It does not begin, for Elmer, it did not begin this past week. Eternal life for Elmer began, as I was reading his life, when he was 20, and he was listening on the radio, and he gave his heart to Jesus. Eternal life for Elmer began right then. Oh, he had 78 more years of eternal life here on this earth, but the gospel was bringing him to his Savior. And now he is standing and seeing his Savior face to face. So as we conclude this morning, let me read verse 32 again. Now I commend you to God and to the word of his grace, which is able to build you up and give you the inheritance among all those who are sanctified. C.S. Lewis said it this way, all that is not eternal is eternally useless. Think about your past week. How much of it was eternal, and how much of it was eternally useless? John Wesley put it this way, I judge all things only by the price they shall gain in eternity. Not by the price that they shall gain in the stock market, not by the price they shall gain next week or the week following. Eternity. John Ortberg said, for many of us, the great danger is not that we will renounce our faith. It is that we will become so distracted, rushed, and preoccupied that we will settle for a mediocre version of our commitment to following Christ. Isn't that true? Aren't there so many distractions in this world that get me preoccupied from the thing that should be most precious? Jesus. And again, that's why that gospel primer to me is so beneficial, because it can daily point me to him and what the gospel has done for each and every one of us. Jonathan Edwards said, resolved that I will live so as I will wish I had done when I come to die. Really, no regrets. as we lay there taking our final breath, oh, have we lived perfectly? No. But are we living with regrets? Are we living with eternity in view? And of course, I saved the best one for last. Are we living this week being faithful with the gifts that God has given each and every one of us here to stand before Christ and hear, well done? So this morning, I commend you to God. No one greater. I commend you to God and the word of his grace, so that each and every one of us someday stand before him and hear, well done. To help us meditate on that and that eternal truth, we're going to watch a video of well done, well done. And then Steve Nace is going to come and dismiss us in prayer.
What will it be like when my pain is gone and all the worries of this world just fade away? What will it be like when you call my name in that moment when I see you face to face? I'm waiting my whole life to hear you say, for that day. Until then, I'll live to hear you say, well,
just a reminder for each and every one of you that are here today that next Sunday evening from 6:30 until 8 o'clock in Boyer Hall, we'll be having a time of farewell for Dave and the Hockman family. We would ask that you would consider coming out and being able to let Pastor Dave and Deb and the family know how much you appreciated their 3.5 years of service here. Well, Dave, we don't say goodbye here. We say so long, because goodbye is final, and we hope and pray and that we'll be able to see your face often in the next years and months to come. So let's go to the Lord in prayer as we dismiss this evening and or this morning, and thank you so much for being faithful in coming out and hearing the Word of God preached this morning. We were truly blessed for making the effort, and we thank you for that. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Our Father in heaven, as we have looked at Acts chapter 20 and verse 32, and Lord, you have commended us through your word, we would like to commend the Hockman family to you. Lord, we would ask that you would bless them in every endeavor that they pursue, that you would probably not make things smooth for them, but Lord, allow them to rely upon you in this journey that they have chosen. Lord, as Acts chapter 20 and verse 32 said, we commend the Hockman family to you that they may be built up. Dave in his new endeavor, Deb in the supporting role of wife and mother, and for the children as they adjust to a new life again. We pray that each and every time that they hear the words Calvary Bible Church mentioned, and they'll hear it over at Lancaster Bible College, that they'll remember their time here and smile. Lord, that each time they return, that when they come through those doors, that they will find us faithful to the Word of God and to each other. Thank you for their 3.5 years here. You knew we needed them. They knew that they needed us. And so as we say so long and not goodbye, we want to thank you for the time here and for not letting us orphans with the godly pastors who remain with us. So, Father, as we depart today, we first of all want to thank you for the privilege of going out into the beauty that you've laid before us, the tapestry that you have painted, the beauty of the snow. And, Lord, we want to leave not only the Hockman family, but also each and every one seated within the pew, your words in the book of Numbers, which say, the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. For it's in the matchless name of Jesus Christ that we pray these words with thanksgiving. Amen. You are dismissed. Thank you.